The only question every single person has me, has for me, wherever I am in the world, is what's it like to work for Trump? You know, and I've met, you know, President Duque, and one of the first things he said, so what's it like to work for President Trump? Like, everybody, you know, presidents to cab drivers, it's the most common, I think, curiosity in the world right now is like, what is that guy like? You know?
This is a country where we speak English, not Spanish.
Should be thinking about how can your child become bilingual, right?
Lafayette Park, or the President's Park, is located right across the White House. It is named after the Marquis de Lafayette, a French military leader who secured American victory during the American Revolution. He was one of George Washington's most trusted commanders. Probably heard this a million times, but this park is a hotspot for tourists and activists. Well, there's also the locals.
What's this?
It is the perfect site to chat with Fernando Cutts.
Oh, I agree.
A former high-ranking official who was a regular at the West Wing of this iconic mansion. He even managed to survive the Obama-Trump transition. Yeah, and wind up working with the Donald during his first year in office.
No fue fácil. Briefing President Obama was completely different than briefing President Trump. President Obama would get, you know, these long briefers, and he would kind of really go into them and tear them apart and take notes on the margins and everything else. President Trump, would get very, very short briefers, you know, note cards that we kind of put bullet points on. And their level of kind of questioning and their prior experiences were also completely different.
Fernando is an expert on U.S. national security and foreign policy, especially when it comes to Latin America. During his time at the White House, he became President Obama's special advisor during his historic visit to Cuba in 2016.
¿Cuál fue el legado del presidente Barack Obama para Latinoamérica?
Creo que Cuba es una de las cosas más importantes que el presidente Obama ha hecho en América Latina y para su legacy. If you look at what President Obama did, if you look at what he left behind when it comes to kind of major historic events in the world, I think a few things come to mind. You know, I think he did a different approach on Cuba, he did a different approach on Iran, he did a different approach on Myanmar and Burma. Not just responding to fires, but actually taking a step back and having a strategic legacy he wants to leave behind, I'd say those are the three things. You could argue whether, you know, each one succeeded or didn't, but I think those are the real focuses of his foreign policy team.
¿Qué crees que está detrás de la nueva manera en cómo Estados Unidos está viendo otra vez a Cuba, si Cuba realmente no es ya una amenaza?
If you look at Cuba, really in the last 65 years, you know, 66 years roughly, it hasn't changed a whole lot. What has changed is the United States. We're the ones who kind of keep changing the way we want to deal with them. What they do on a day-to-day basis, how they act, the human rights abuses, repression of their people, the lack of democracy, all of that, that's stayed the same. So when you talk about U.S. foreign policy towards Cuba, it's really shifts in us, in our politics, and it swings in our politics. I think Cuba is a unique country when it comes to foreign policy, whereas most of the countries in the world, certainly that I've worked on foreign policy-wise, we follow foreign policies that are based on purely kind of strategic logic. When it comes to Cuba, it's a very different beast. There's a lot of passion, a lot of personal interests, people who have been affected one way or another by Cuba, people who have ambitions one way or another for Cuba. And so it's created this pendulum effect where it keeps changing a lot, even though on the island itself, remarkably little has changed in the last 60 plus years.
Cuando se habla de derechos humanos desde Cuba, uno dice, bueno, los derechos humanos, pero la política de derechos humanos pareciera tener un doble estándar dependiendo pues, del país, porque hay conversaciones con Corea del Norte, se mantiene un diálogo fluido con el régimen de Arabia Saudita. ¿Eso cómo se le puede vender al público?
It's a tough question because I think, you know, as you really think through kind of what our foreign policy is and how we can stay kind of consistent as we engage in foreign policy around the world, part of our challenge is managing the the goodwill of the region, as we have to in Latin America when we're dealing with Cuba. But part of our challenge is also, calling something out if it's there. I don't necessarily, know how to defend the policy of Saudi Arabia that the team in charge right now is pursuing. And I don't necessarily know how to defend, the quick rapprochement we had with North Korea. But it doesn't change the fact that there are human rights problems in Cuba, right? So it's two kind of correlated yet in mm-hmm. some ways uncorrelated things. Whether or not the way to react to the Cuba crisis is through what we do, that's a legitimate question. But the fact that there are human rights abuses in Cuba, I think that's undisputable, right? Now, what it merits, that's up in the air.
Fernando is originally from Brazil and loves football. I mean, the guy was even a FIFA ref before joining the U.S. government.
I'm not sure what is more exciting on a day-to-day basis, if it was working in this West Wing specifically.
And he continued to blow the whistle. As the White House Director for South America and Western Hemisphere Affairs, he was in charge of designing the strategy behind the staggering sanctions against Venezuela's Maduro regime.
This game is tougher than it looks.
¿Qué crees que no hizo la administración pasada que falló en el tema de Venezuela hasta llegar a la situación de ahora?
I think the problem we have in U.S. foreign policy in general is that we are very reactive. I think we all recognize that. In the two administrations I worked, I think people actively tried to address that, but it's very hard because, you always have big things in the news. You always have some big crisis that you have to deal with at the moment. Policy experts have been saying for a while now that, hey, this is going to be a really bad thing. Since Chavez came into power, and everybody's been saying, hey, people are leaving, there's a brain drain, hey, there's, the oil sector, PDVSA is going downhill, hey, the socialism isn't working, the model that they're using isn't going to sustain itself. But it wasn't until we got to the point of a real crisis that it captured the full attention of the White House. As this crisis continues to expand, you see migration issues that are really creating a crisis in Colombia and Brazil and in Peru and Ecuador, and you have to assume that eventually that problem might start moving its way up to the United States. If you see a failed state in our neighborhood, that will have ramifications that could spread throughout the neighborhood and eventually hit us. And that, I think, is potentially a bigger national security threat than anything else for us.
Random 4.
What's up, guys? If you enjoy our content, don't forget to share it. Then smash the like button and, of course, hit the sub button. If you're curious about a random topic, let us know in the comments, and we'll do the best to take care of the rest. Later, debaters. Don't forget to click on notifications so you don't miss a thing.